Hi, let's talk about the pancreas. In this video, we'll discuss the basic structure, features, and orientation of the pancreas. The pancreas is an organ of the foregut. It's predominantly exocrine in nature, but it has a very important endocrine function. The islets of Langerhans help to regulate blood glucose levels. The pancreas is predominantly secondarily retroperitoneal, excepting the tail of the pancreas, which is nestled adjacent to the hilum of the spleen. And so both the tail of the pancreas as well as the spleen are intraperitoneal organs. There are four major parts to the pancreas. There is the head of the pancreas, which is the most robust part. It's through the head that the common bile duct, as well as the main pancreatic duct, and if present, accessory pancreatic duct, will run and pierce through the wall of the second part of the duodenum to secrete into the lumen. The head also includes a small process called the uncinate process, which isn't very well illustrated here. We'll see it on an upcoming illustration. The uncinate process is found just posterior to these vessels. And this would be the superior mesenteric artery and the superior mesenteric vein. So just tucked in posterior to the SMA and SMV is that uncinate process of the head. Adjacent to the head is the neck of the pancreas, and contiguous with the neck is the body of the pancreas that extends sort of supero left laterally out towards the spleen. And the distal portion of the pancreas is the tail of the pancreas. Now let's take a look at the relationships of these parts of the pancreas to other organs. So the head is very well snuggled by the duodenum. So the duodenum has a nice C shape to it, and that very robust head and all of the ducts that are conveyed through that robust head are found surrounded by duodenum on three sides. The uncinate process is found posterior to the SMA and SMV, which we've discussed, and we'll see this in another illustration quite well. The neck of the pancreas is a really important and rather complicated anatomically relations-wise part of the pancreas. It is immediately posterior to the pyloric part of the stomach. It's anterior to those superior mesenteric vessels, and it's also anterior to a very important origin, and that is of the hepatic portal vein. So what happens is the superior mesenteric vein arises and meets with the splenic vein to form the hepatic portal vein, and that is just posterior to the neck of the pancreas. Let's erase some of this. The body of the pancreas is found posterior to the stomach, and the tail of the pancreas is found nestled adjacent to the hilum of the spleen. So the totality of the pancreas is secondarily retroperitoneal, and the exception is this tail, which is intraperitoneal. As a glandular organ of both exocrine and endocrine nature, the pancreas is going to be known for its secretions. The endocrine portions of the pancreas are going to secrete into capillaries that will permeate the pancreas, whereas the exocrine portions of the parenchyma, which are the majority of the pancreas, will secrete into ducts. So these ducts all are going to coalesce into one of two ducts. We have the main pancreatic duct, sometimes just known as the pancreatic duct, which is going to join with the common bile duct. So that is the pancreatico-biliary junction there. Where they come together is the hepatopancreatic ampulla, sometimes known as the ampulla of Vader. And that ampulla is going to drain through the major duodenal papilla, an eruption of mucosa in the second part of the duodenum. And pancreatic juice will be expelled into the duodenum there, as will bile. It is possible for the bile duct and the main pancreatic duct to independently drain into the second part of the duodenum. There may also be, although this is not a constant, an accessory pancreatic duct, which drains the superior portion of the head of the pancreas, and if it is present, it will drain through the minor duodenal papilla. These duodenal papillae are going to be found in the medial wall of the second part of the duodenum. The major duodenal papilla is an anatomical landmark which divides the foregut from the midgut, and it's typically found distal to the minor duodenal papilla. That main pancreatic duct is sometimes known as the duct of Wirsung. The accessory pancreatic duct is sometimes known as the duct of Santorini. If there is any issue of edema here, either through infection or if there is a neoplastic growth affecting the head of the pancreas, this can be very problematic physiologically because it can occlude the flow of bile and of pancreatic juice into the small intestines. And so it can affect secretions into the duodenum. The blood supply of the pancreas is quite extensive and will be the focus of another learning objective. The pancreas shares quite a bit of blood supply with the duodenum, as one might imagine. And there are four major sources of blood to the pancreas. So the gastroduodenal artery, which is a branch of the common hepatic artery of the celiac trunk, is one of the major blood suppliers to the pancreas. So this will give rise to the posterior superior pancreatico-duodenal artery, the anterior superior pancreatico-duodenal artery, the duodenal arteries, which also will give rise to branches to the head of the pancreas as well. There's an inferior pancreatico-duodenal artery from the superior mesenteric artery, or SMA, which has anterior and posterior branches, which anastomose with those anterior, posterior, superior pancreatico-duodenal branches of the gastroduodenal artery. The splenic artery is a very robust and tortuous branch of the celiac trunk, and that's going to give rise to very many important branches of artery which supply the pancreas. So, for instance, the dorsal pancreatic artery, which is then contiguous with the inferior pancreatic artery. There's also the great or greater pancreatic artery, as well as the artery to the tail of the pancreas. And if that isn't enough, we also have branches of jejunal arteries from the superior mesenteric artery that can supply blood to the pancreas as well. In terms of innervation, sort of the The guideline here is think of the vasculature that serves the organ, and the innervation will follow, and that's no exception to that guideline here. So surrounding the celiac trunk is the celiac plexus, which derives its fibers from the thoracic splanchnic nerves as well as the posterior vagal trunk. Sympathetics from the thoracic splanchnics, parasympathetics from the posterior vagal trunk. And so those fibers will be conducted along the celiac artery and its branches to the pancreas. Also, any arterial branches from the superior mesenteric artery located there from the superior mesenteric plexus will also serve the pancreas. So parasympathetic stimulation, rest and digest, will lead to exocrine secretion as well as vasodilation, so an active pancreas, whereas sympathetic stimulation will lead to vasoconstriction and the inhibition of exocrine secretion. So quite the opposite of rest and digest there. General visceral afferent or GVA fibers that conduct visceral pain will follow sympathetic fibers here. So referred pain from the pancreas will be to the epigastric region. So we've discussed the pancreas, its parts, their orientations and relative locations to other structures, the pattern of exocrine drainage of the pancreas, blood supply to the pancreas, as well as innervation of the pancreas. This is your summary slide. Thank you for your time.